I was busy watching Evan DeVito highlights.
Danny DeVito highlights.
Evan DeVito.
Danny DeVito, what, in the in Batman, as he was the Penguin?
I have to get my microphone on the screen somehow.
You're in like a real room, like an office or something. What happened?
No, this is the Colon Academy. This is our homeschooling area.
I like it.
It's not great, but it is what it is.
It is what it is, exactly. So I'm recording already, but we can delete anything. How are you guys doing?
Strikes and gutters. How's everything up in Milwaukee, John? Have you talked to Jono?
I did. I texted him last night. I told him to keep his head about him. And, you know, if it looks like you're in a place that feels wrong, looks wrong, it probably is wrong, and you should not be there.
Right.
So.
Smart. Stay in your dorm.
Yeah.
Stay in your lane.
All right. So we have a bit of an agenda. I guess we should just start with a welcome back. We kind of took summer off with this whole thing. We've been traveling with our day jobs. We've been traveling with lacrosse. We've been dealing with parenting and COVIDing and everything else. And we all just kind of needed to take a breath and take a break away from this. But it seemed to be pretty well received. I think
you got a great haircut.
Yeah, I even got a haircut. Got rid of that goofy mustache. But I was walking through a restaurant in Lake Orion. I went sporting clay shooting with my buddies, and some guy stops me and goes, "Are you Chris Druin?" And I'm thinking, oh, no, yeah, he's why? Asking. And I'm wondering why this guy knows me. He goes, "I love your guys' podcast, man." So somebody was watching
boring.
It. It was fun.
Must be a pretty boring guy.
Well,
you're famous.
We infamous, maybe. But we did strike a nerve, and I guess I'm glad to say it's good to see you guys. And it's definitely want to get this thing going again as we kind of start getting to some of this stuff. So a couple topics of news I kind of want to hit on right off the bat. Dearborn Divine Child coach Kevin Riley passed away. And anyone that has been a part of Michigan lacrosse, he started playing in Windsor with the Warlocks and then the Warlock Masters and really helped found that whole unified program at Plymouth, Canton, and Salem. Varsity coach, JV coach, everything in there. Kevin then went to run the Canton program when Canton really started to go off on their own and gave them the stability that they have and are well known for now. And then was the inaugural coach at Lawrence Tech back when they didn't have a stadium, when they didn't have, you know, three different Under Armour uniforms and helmets and everything else. Kevin was out there with just a handful of kids that he talked into coming out there and has turned that into a respectable program. And now really one of the leaders of that Wolverine Hoosier Athletic Conference, now that it's in good hands with the new coaching staff. And then Kevin just didn't want to hang it up. Fighting, I believe it was lung cancer for the last 10 years, went to Divine Child and coached there. So I just wanted to recognize Kevin and all of his contributions to the kids he's coached, the places he's coached, the friends he's made along the way. And that's my brief eulogy of Kevin Riley, that if you knew him, you knew how just he was a class act. He was a cop. He's a good guy, and just I'm gonna miss him on the sidelines for lacrosse games. Not sure how well you guys knew him, but those are my thoughts.
I know everybody that he played for him really loved him. So you know, good job, and hopefully he's feeling pretty good now.
Yeah, so I wanted to touch on that first. Kevin, we'll recognize him on the U.S. Lacrosse social media as we kind of get that back going again. And then I don't know if you guys know Eric Frank. He runs the BJ's travel program, but he had a Facebook post the other day that his brother-in-law, who also coaches in the BJ's program, Joey was in a car accident. So I don't know if I've crossed paths with Joey. I know I've connected with Eric through reffing tournaments and BJ Sports and everything, but just we want to keep Joey in our thoughts and prayers as well. You know, we're a small community, and I just want to recognize that I've been praying for him. And Eric, if you see this, we're thinking about him. And then a non-lacrosse one, Cranbrook's varsity football coach just passed away in a car accident. And we know how small some of this lacrosse community is in some of these smaller schools. So just three people that I want to recognize, keeping in our thoughts and prayers. And I'm not sure if John, you know, so many Rice kids and Cranbrook kids are friends and everything. Not sure if you had any interactions with them.
Yeah, I mean, it was a shock. I mean, I met him once or twice, so I wasn't close by any means. But, you know, I think, you know, it just shows that you have to value every single day, you know, that there is no tomorrow. And so, you know, that's one thing through all of this that I've really focused on. And when these tragedies strike, it just brings it even closer to hit home that we got to appreciate everything we have. We're all very blessed. Yeah. And you got to count your blessings every day and try to be the best person you can be every single day.
You know, the Cranbrook coach guy named Ben Jones, and he played football at Hillsdale, and a ton of Rice kids have gone on to Hillsdale and played football over the years, including some of the Plasky brothers. And I know that he was working for the Schwartz family doing financial planning in Bloomfield. So everyone, we know the Schwartz family. So don't want to start off on a complete downer. Yeah. But
I will say this. I want one comment on that. He got hit by a drunk driver.
He did.
Mind his own business, doing his thing. And so
going to practice. It wasn't even like
poor choice, and got in the car, got behind the wheel. So let's make sure that you know, you see anybody doing that, you never do it yourself. And if you see somebody doing it, you have an obligation to stop them, because you know a guy like that who's given so much, it just stinks.
Taken so senselessly.
Yeah.
So okay, I guess as I want to take a deep breath after that. It's good to see you guys. I do want to transition into some stuff. John was nice enough to put together a bit of an agenda for us. No guests tonight, no interviews in history and lessons, just kind of an excuse for us to get reset and talk about what's going on in the game of lacrosse, what happened over the summer, what's going on with Coach Colin's program, what's going on with the MHSAA practices, fall ball, spring football, all that craziness and madness. I'm going to really try to bite my tongue and play moderator because I have some pretty passionate thoughts on this and I don't want to get myself in trouble. But as far as the summer went, John, give us a quick update on what you saw with a bunch of, I mean, you were everywhere. How many tournaments did you go to this summer?
I want to say 9. I think 9 was the final number. I mean, it ran from the first tournament was the end of June. So that was the first tournament actually anywhere. And that was down at, I mean, you know, Indianapolis, you know, really the Carmel area is now my second home, looking at apartments down there potentially for ongoing, just because I think.
Well, just all the broadcasting opportunities.
Exactly. You know, as we get into this, you know, and as we go forward, even in the fall, I think you're going to see a plethora of lacrosse events down in Indiana area in Westfield, that complex down there in Westfield, Indiana is just massive. And, you know, so I was down there at the end of June, I celebrated my 50th birthday down there.
Happy birthday
to me. And so, yeah, hit that tournament. Then we were off for the 4th of July, and then it was every single weekend and then during the week as well. And so it went, the next weekend was not Rip the Duck, but the other one was in South. So we went from Indianapolis, then we went to South Bend, then we went back to Indianapolis, then we were just outside of Louisville, then back to Indianapolis again, then flew to D.C. from Indianapolis, drove to Philly, drove to Delaware, drove to Columbia, Maryland, then back to Delaware, then flew home. And so it was, yeah, I mean, it was, I kept track of it on social media. It was 5,000 miles. It was 5,000 miles and, you know, multiple hotels. I mean, you know, 7 hotels, rental cars, plane rides. I mean, I did it all and you know, I wore my mask and I followed the guidelines, and every state was different and every tournament was different. That was the interesting thing, you know, with these big tournaments, as you guys know, you know, they got to follow the rules. They got to make people safe. And some were more stringent than others. But, you know, everyone was, you know, making the announcements. There was always that announcement over the loudspeaker at every tournament. Hey, we, you know, everyone needs masks and social distancing and all those things. But you know, in the end, you know, parents are, I mean, they, you know, every tournament we went to, they blocked off really the stands. Anywhere that there was stands, they blocked off. And so what did you end up getting? You end up getting parents congregating on the sidelines or, you know, around the field where there was really no social distancing. And yeah. So I thought, you know, my one comment right out of the gate was that, you know, I think the term is if you've got stands, you can actually then social distance. I mean, you tape off here, sit here. But when it all comes down to it, I mean, it's everybody's choice on how they're going to handle it. And parents and kids, I mean, that it went the way that it went. You know, I heard a couple of rumblings about some kids, you know, picking up COVID, testing positive. I didn't hear anything about any parents or coaches or any, you know, older folks. You know, I was, you know, knock on wood, healthy and nothing, you know, I've been home long enough now where I didn't have anything. And it was great to see the kids. I mean, it was every day. And you think, you know, I went 11 straight days of lacrosse and travel and, you know, I was in heaven and I could have kept doing it. It was, yeah. It was great. And I do it again and I can't wait for fall.
So, you know, I want to make the joke of, you know, with Steve Martin and John Candy there every step of the way, as you were on all the planes, trains and automobiles. You know, I'll mention this. I had lunch with a dad that his son is leaving for college next week, a 2020 player. One of the protocols for him going off to college was he had to be COVID tested before he got on campus. And then he'll have to be COVID tested again once he is on campus and you know, starts participating with the team. Had the antibodies. Never showed a symptom. Never had a clue. Never anything. 18-year-old kid healthy. Didn't have a sniffle all summer. You know, who knows? If you had been exposed, if somebody has, you know, it's Chris had mentioned that he had heard some rumors about some people getting, you know, positive tests, but what I guess I'm hearing from all these tournaments is people were trying to follow the guidelines that were mandated. You know, I go back to, you know, the May 22nd CDC report that said, okay, maybe you can't get it from contact now. Maybe you can. We don't think that's the way, you know, the rules kept changing. Ethan, while you were on the road going from tournament one to tournament nine, the latest Fauci report, the latest CDC seems to keep changing, but it seems like the lacrosse community, no tantrums, no panics, no riots, no outbreaks, no finger pointing, no blame. Everyone just kind of got back to work and played ball and behaved.
Yeah, besides the masks, you know, that was, and the announcements, and some tournaments had checkpoints. I know the Corrigan Sports tournament that we were at, you know, they had checkpoints, but
like thermometer guns kind of thing.
Yeah. They took everybody's temperature walking in and you know, they mandated, you know, a lot of terms are very good about the players. Right. So, you know, the players made sure that they had their temperature taken every day. The Corrigan tournament, for instance, gave out wristbands to all the players or little, you know, kind of the things you get when you go to a movie or a bar or whatever, little paper ones that confirm that they had their temperature checked. You know, some of the programs, I mean, I was working with three different programs on my tour with my kids that, you know, and they had the apps, you know, and made sure that, you know, people checked in. And so we had to fill out just a little short questionnaire every single day before practice and obviously before the tournaments as well, saying, have you had a temperature? You know, do you have any symptoms? And then you had to verify it and click it and move along. But, you know, other than that, it wasn't overtaxing or over in your face. I mean, you know, this last one I was at in Pennsylvania, in Hershey, Pennsylvania, you know, they drove around and they were mandating it and there were people on golf carts. And if you had your mask down, even if you had one, they said, you know, sir, can you pull up your mask? Yeah. So they were pretty stringent in that regards. But I think it varied from state to state, you know, Indiana, you know, just the way that they are and the way that they, you know, that the way that they're set up in terms of what they're doing in their state compared to Delaware, compared to Pennsylvania, you know, compared to Maryland. It varied state to state and tournament to tournament.
So I guess I'll kind of ask this then, because as the three of us have been on the group texts all summer, we haven't really had the momentum in number of conversations we've had as we did in the middle of COVID when we were recording three of these things a week and talking all day in between them. Coach, what have you done this summer with lacrosse? I know you've spent time on UDM's campus. I know you've seen your players. I know that you've done some hiring of some new coaches. But recruiting what too. Was the recruiting trail like for you? Was there a recruiting trail, or are we looking at your seat for all the recruiting you did?
This is how I recruited.
Wow.
You know, I'm a big believer in asking a lot about I've always asked coaches and people and done a lot of research on kids and then followed up by watching them play. So we did a little bit more on film this year than we've ever done. I'd like to see people in person. I'd like to get back to that as soon as I can. But this is what I did all summer. Sat like this and watched, I had watched a lot of film, and it's not as good. It's not even close, but then you had to rely on, people that you trust to tell you how kids are and you know, the kind of people they are and what kind of work ethic they have. So, you know, you just do the best you can.
Any broadcasters on those films, Coach? And would that have helped had there been a high quality broadcaster?
You know, some of the major ones had some, you know, John, I'll be honest, not as good as you, and I'm not just saying that, but they had some pretty kind of low budget commentary on a few of the games. Even the high school ones that made it to ESPN, I don't think were that great. That didn't really help. It would have been nice to have something to follow along. Some clubs did a nice job of giving you supporting documentation while you were watching, so that kind of helped.
Big numbers? How were the numbers in the jerseys? I know that was a big thing.
Well, guys, this year people did really well. I mean, it was nice. People did a nice job. Everyone's doing the best they can with the situation. Yeah. So it was nice to see.
You guys have heard me vent on that before. My biggest pet peeve in summer tournaments is they're worried so much about how cool it looks or the sublimated logo or how crazy and outlandish our jersey can be. And you can't see the kids' numbers. And then when you get the film, or especially as a ref when you're doing the game, you're trying to pick out which kid the foul was on, and you just see the front of the jersey. Speaking of which, I am wearing the Detroit Hooligans jersey. Number 40 is Higgins, if you were aware of that. I got the Higgins jersey.
Nice.
So, I hope that this is the new trend that coaches realize that if my kid wants to be recruited, the number on the front and the number on the back need to be big and bold so that the coach watching the film from Detroit, Michigan, from Royal Oak, Michigan, of your tournament in Carmel, Indiana, it's not about how cool the jersey looks. Nobody's joining your team because of how cool your jersey looks. Make sure that they can be noticed and be seen. So it's good to hear that trend was better. As the season started, you know, tournament one through tournament, you know, the end of it, Chris, did the broadcast get better? Did it seem like those streaming services got the hang of what they were doing?
No, I mean, it was...
Was it streaming? Was it streaming?
No, I never watched it. I watched everything.
I didn't see any streaming. Any of the tournaments I was at, there was no streaming. It was all filmed, but it was there was never anything that was live.
I mean,
games at the NHSLS, but that was it.
Yeah, I just got the adrenaline, all the adrenaline tournaments today. So, okay. I was watching film of a couple kids right before this. So, I mean, this is what we do now, so.
Hey, have you talked to any other coaches? Or is there any, like, secret best practices group between you and some of your buddies? Is there, like, don't share film or you know, what's, because normally you guys are sitting in lawn chairs at the same tournaments as your buddies, your competitors, your friendly competitors with some of them, you'll get a beer afterwards, you'll have lunch with them. There's no coaching fraternity for you to talk with. How's this been in the bubble?
You know, we're all pirates, so I don't think, I think it's been a little, at least I, from my standpoint, it's been a little bit more quiet because we're all trying to figure out what the best practices are. And, you know, we all think we're pretty smart. So, I've personally gone with a little bit more of the relationships and going for kids where I know coaches and know high school coaches and know people that know people versus straight following a kid that I think I like. So
gotcha.
Relationships have mattered for me. I don't know about other people. And, you know, when I talk to other college coaches, we're talking about much other things than recruiting is probably 10th on the list right now with everything that's going on.
Gotcha.
Yeah.
And you picked up a lot of transfers. I mean, that was, you picked a lot of, a plethora of kids coming through that you picked up.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, it was, again, half of that was started before all this went down. So, I think for most kids, the only thing I'll say about recruiting that I think is pretty important for kids around here in Michigan and in general is the process is going to go a lot slower. I think there'd be opportunities all the way up to the end of your senior season where that might have not been, where it's slowed down. I think one of the gifts of COVID, hopefully for some kids, is, they're going to fully mature into the kind of the athlete that they're going to be in high school, and there's going to be a lot more opportunities for those kids. So,
Let me ask you a question on that specifically, but then I kind of want to hop into what fall and club is going to look like. And I want to wrap this up talking about UDM specifically and what the future looks like for you with some of these kids that transfer and all that stuff. But as you mentioned, that now a kid that might have graduated or his last film when he was over the summer circuit was when he was 17. Now he graduates high school at 18. Maybe now he's more mature, plays that later. We've got guys that are going to get an extra year of eligibility. We've talked about it within your program, guys like Jars coming back for one more year. How many years do you think there's going to take for this backlog of kids to work itself through where you think it's going to be a full 4-year cycle?
Yeah. And again, as this continues, the NCAA is trying, they're making it pretty easy for kids. And that's probably the right thing to do, but that's putting, there's a lot of stress on a lot of different academic institutions that are, lacrosse is not played by a lot of the Power Five schools, right? And that's not really funded that way. So it just puts more of a financial stress on everything from our end. But, on one side, you get more opportunities because there's, I think things are slowing down. The other side of it is the actual opportunities are a little bit less because rosters, coaches are going to go with not some, some schools are saying, hey, leave. There's some schools that don't have master's degrees. All Jars, all those guys that are coming back, McLean, they're all in 5-year engineering programs, 5-year MBAs. So they would have came back as continuing ed graduate students. And we would have had them chasing ball. McLean would have been chasing balls, across the street on 7 Mile, 6 Mile.
And, yeah.
Doing that kind of stuff, but instead he gets to play. So, it's been kind of an interesting and difficult thing to do mathematically with scholarships. But those guys were going to be around anyway, which is good for us for schools that don't have that, our friends up at Colgate, where they don't have master's degrees. It's a lot harder to convince a kid to stay for a fifth year.
Yeah. Right. Okay.
And don't you think, to your point of the, really that the end of their senior season or during that time frame that you're going to see, some Division II and Division III schools probably pick up some really good kids?
Yeah.
That just blossom, as you said, and really, we're getting looks or maybe not getting looks, and then all of a sudden, hey, I got a pretty good stud here just out of the rough.
Yep. Oh yeah. I think that's going to be. It's just going to move a little bit slower, and I know we are.
Patience.
Right. So.
Okay. So, quick transition away from that. We're going to touch on recruiting a little bit more. Anyone that follows Losey or myself on Twitter, we've been very vocal about how upset we are with the MHSAA, with the governor's office, with the cancellation/postponement/ the UP can play / this zone can't play / this zone can play, and how it's going to affect specifically for me the lacrosse community. and the kids that didn't have a 2020 season and what this means for them in 2021. John, you have your finger on the pulse as a dad of two high school players. You have a boy that's a senior and you have a girl that's a freshman. Give us, if you can, the current status of what is allowed for fall practice with high school coaches and their teams, mm-hmm. and what the current MHSAA hopes and dreams of what spring will look like for football and basketball and lacrosse and everything else.
Yeah, I mean, it's – I've been very vocal, as you know, to use your word, about not punishing the spring sports again, right? Yeah. I mean, they have lost a season. That's a fact, right? There is no lacrosse state champion in 2020. None. It's vacant. Zero. None. No baseball state champ. And so, you know, those
not
are
even
there.
The championships, not a game.
Right.
Not so, a single 2020 graduate got to play a game wearing right. their varsity letters.
And so, you know, my whole angst on Twitter, you know, people think that I'm just, you know, fighting to save football. And while, yes, I mean, the kids are important and football is important. I get it. But I'm more, you know, I'm more, you know, really vocal about the fact that football not playing in the fall means that they're going to play in the spring. And lacrosse and baseball and softball. And I mean, just go down the list of the spring sports that are going to get bumped. And it's going to be a reduced season. And it's going to be 12 regular season games and then the full playoffs, right, or the full tournament. I mean, that's kind of the way that it's going to shake out. And I'm like, all right, so let me get this straight. Lacrosse as a sport is going to lose an entire season. So they lost 18 regular season games, plus the playoffs, plus scrimmages, plus all the practice time. And now they're going to lose, you know, 6 regular season games, 4 scrimmages, and 2 months of practice time. And I think one of the reasons that, you know, the MHSA came out with a ruling about practice in the fall, and now they're allowing high school lacrosse coaches to coach their teams. They've got 16 practices that can take place between September 8th and October 31st. And so if a high school wants to go, they're going to go 2 days a week for those 8 weeks. And that's going to be what it's going to be. And it can be varsity, you know, JV, whatever it is, a mix. But they've stated clearly no competitions. So it's strictly practice. They got 16 of them and your coaching staff can do it. And as long as the school allows it, you know, it's going to happen. And so there's a big buzz. You know, I've had numerous calls and numerous conversations with numerous coaches around the state on what they're going to do, how they're going to handle it, what it's going to look like, how it's going to affect the club situation. Because, you know, when football was pushed back in the club world, it was game on, right? Now we're the only game in town and, you know, we're going to maximize that and play and start playing early. So you've got club teams now that have already built out schedules where they're going to start practicing in September as well, with tournaments to follow in October and also in November. So I think there's going to be a lot of opportunity. I think it's going to be a very busy fall, which of course I enjoy and I love. But you know, the other shoe to drop on the other side of it is, what's the spring going to look like? You know, how are you going to play football and start it in February in the UP? I mean, you're not getting to play lacrosse, right? I mean, so I don't know what that's going to look like. I have no idea. One of the things that I was, you know, down on the MHSA for is that, you know, you make this decision, this monumental decision, right? And I get now, and I've gone back on Twitter and said, listen, you know, my angst is directed at the MHSA, but it's not as much. I can now direct it towards the governor's office, because in the end, they just canceled the season or pushed the season because that's what she wanted. And in their mind, they felt that she was going to do it anyway. And, you know, whether it was for political cover or not, I don't know. But our governor's office has not stated what, you know, what do they want? You know, I mean, she made that announcement back at the end of June to say, you know, I'd really like the MHSA to think about pushing football and sports back, right? I mean, it was kind of that nudge, nudge, wink, wink. And I think the MHSA just said, you know, she's going to do it anyway, regardless of what the vote is, because the majority of the schools did vote to go forward with the football season. I don't know what the spring is going to look like, but I know that lacrosse is going to get the short end of the stick because.
All right, hold on. Colin's trying to say something.
No, John, she's been very clear about it needs to get under 30 cases per million. I mean, or whatever, that 30 cases per million situation where she's going to open theaters, open stuff up. I mean, I think that communication has been clear. Whether you agree with it or not, that's up to you.
There's a difference between phase four and phase five, right? So you're taking it now out of the context of high school athletics.
Oh, yeah. Right?
And now you're putting it into the state piece of it. So, you know, if there's a correlation between what you can and cannot do based on that phase five, then she could have come out and said, no football until we get to phase five. And she never said that.
From my understanding, that was, you know, movie theaters, gyms, and kind of that high school football was all part of that phase situation where we got below that certain number. So
again, you know, when you look at Michigan compared to the rest of the country, we rank 38th in the number of cases based on 1 million of population. 38.
Yeah, so, I'm just saying it was clear. I mean, whether you agree with it or not, it's pretty clear. If we get below a certain number, the state's going to get opened up. And that's what, I mean, we can, you know, the MHSAA had their experts. She has her experts. California has their experts. Florida has their experts. Wisconsin has their experts. I mean, we can complain all we want about all the different things.
I get it. But if that was the case, then the MHSAA would never have had to come out and make an announcement. Right? I mean, why would they need to make an announcement if it's clear that no high school sports or no high school football until phase five? And then everyone would know it. There's the transparency we need. But that's why there's this confusion and this non-transparency.
Time out. Let me put this up. This is the official Michigan Safe Start plan that the governor's office released.
Yeah.
Stage five, epidemic levels are extremely low and outbreaks can be quickly contained.
Mm.
Health system capacity is strong with robust testing and tracing. Most businesses can reopen, giving adherence to strict safety measures.
Mm.
Chris, if it's out there where she said that what extremely low and quickly and capacity is defined as, I have not read it in nor I have seen it in the official policy. This is the official Safe Start plan. This was put out in May. There's a lot of really vague stuff in here. And I go back to what Losi was saying, where when football kicked off, there was no definition of we have to be at level five, and level five means this many per million or this, you know, that's where I, the football coach at Rice tweeted something out about how he felt like they didn't tell us what we had to meet. They said we could start. They said they'd give us an answer by this date. Then they moved it up a week. My upset with that was Friday at 4:00. I thought was a cowardly move to announce it going into a news cycle like that. Besides the point about when the announcement was, but I'm an old PR guy. If you announce something at Friday at 4:00, it's because you're trying to bury it and you don't have to answer questions for 48 hours.
Right.
My problem with that was, you know, I said in response to that tweet, okay, let's not define lower or safer or better. Let's define the science of it. Because as we're seeing now, certain restaurants can open, but certain bars can't. Casinos can open, but gyms can't. Soccer is safe. Lacrosse is safe. Football isn't. Like, I want to get some really hard facts and numbers and science behind this. And I feel like there's just too much of this, you know, and again, I'm going to highlight this extremely low. What does extremely low mean? Quickly contained. Does this mean 24 hours? Because right now an outbreak is two or more people. So, you know, I go back to everyone hollering about motorcyclists up in Sturgis. Half a million people were there.
Round and round, right? I mean, we can go round and round this, and that's what the talking heads do all day long, and there's no answer. And Chris, I get it, right? I mean, I understand that. I mean, I get it, right? I mean, we're not the only state to do this. I mean, we've got right now 16 states that have pushed football into the spring, and so, you know, we're not the only one. That being said, you know, it's difficult to listen to her say how well we're doing. And when you look at, you know, the low numbers and you look at everything going down, and you look at 38th in cases, and then for kids at Miles High School in Miles, Michigan, can drive 12 miles and watch South Bend play a game on Friday night, I don't get it. All right. I don't get it. So, but yeah. You know, football's football, right?
I mean, yeah, and that's my only point to that, John, and exactly what you're saying, where we're, again, I'm looking for hard data. And again, the NCAA has different data than any of the states. And my head spins on it too.
Yeah.
What I would hope for is that we would have had some either from our national, you know, and again, I'm trying not to get political, but a national plan of some part where we had these standards set. So we all know what to do. So kids from different states could, you know, a governor could figure out, maybe I want to do this, maybe I don't want to do this, but
Chris,
whether it's U.S. lacrosse, whether it's, you know, you go state to state, I guess we're supposed to follow our state guidelines, but, you know, what stage five in Michigan, what stage five in Florida, and what stage five in Illinois, it's a mess.
Yeah.
Mess. And everyone's trying to do what's right.
I'm not saying they're not, but you know, for us to say that there is a standard, a national standard of where you need to be, because you're seeing spikes at different phases at different times across the country. And, you know, in the political climate that we're in, one side or the other, if you have one person mandating for the entire country, how much upheaval do you think that you would have from each state based on what's going on within their state at that given time to say, hey, you know, we've got our people, you're telling us this, you know, we're not going to listen to that. We're going to do what we're going to do here.
Again, that's my point. Everyone's got different advisors, and, you know, the NCAA has advisors, U of D has advisors, MHSAA has advisors, the governor of Michigan has advisors, the president has advisors, this has advisors, this has advisors, and they're all coming up with different answers.
I've got advisors.
I got an advisor too, right?
I got two.
So that's my point. Like, it's just like you say, you're going, everyone's coming up with different answers. Like, this makes no sense to me. And if we're going to get somewhere, in my opinion, and again, as a guy who's really wants a season in the spring, you know, I'd like a set of rules that everyone can follow, that we all, you know, can get on board with and get behind and get businesses going and get teams going and get football going and lacrosse going. Get the whole thing going, but we need something to hold on to.
This stuff's going to go. I mean, it's going to go, right? I mean, lacrosse, if we get back to the topic of lacrosse is going, right? I mean, you look at what happened in the summer. I mean, it was every weekend. I mean, people are going and they're playing and clubs are going to happen. So all that ends up happening is that, you know, I get it from a liability standpoint, from a school perspective, but, you know, kids are doing it. I mean, it's going to happen. And so if, you know, in my mind, I'm saying, all right, who's going to control it better? Is it a club? Is it traveling to Delaware and then to Philly and then back and forth? Or is it a high school that can control what's going on, right? I can control practice. I can control how they get to games. I can control after the game. I can do whatever I want. You know, I've got that ability to do it more so than just letting everyone run free and run from club to club and state to state.
Right. I know. I agree. But then you go, what's the core mission of a educational institution? I could say sports, but
sports is
not it. It's education. So then sports get put to the side a little bit, right?
Hold on. I'm going to say one thing on that. We know within the programs that we respect the most, it's about character. It's about personal development. It's about growth. It's about that athletic field being an extension of the classroom, an opportunity for those kids to grow as leaders and learn hard work and learn all this stuff. Yeah. That isn't just coaches speak for us. Isn't coaches speak for you.
I don't think Chris means
the character that you look for in your kids.
See the value of sports. I get it. I mean, we can go round and round again. We all are on the same page that sports make a difference in kids' lives and the development. Right? Is it the most important thing? Absolutely not. And in the spring, when it was canceled, no one complained, right? I mean, everyone understood because it was clear why we were doing it, right? We were canceling this because of something that it was an outbreak, it was a pandemic. We need to shut down to make sure that our hospital system can handle this pandemic, right? And so that was good, right? There wasn't any uproar, right, of the spring sports being canceled. I mean, towards the end, maybe could we do something, but no one did across the country, right? There was no lacrosse season last year for any high school in the country. But now,
the only thing that I think we argued about was, can we not cancel it 6 months out, 5 months out? Can we just
timing? It was timing. Yeah, timing. Yeah. What are you going to do, right? Yeah. What are you going to do?
We had those conversations. They were fun. Yeah,
exactly. But now we're in a situation where you've got, you know, if it continues the way it's going, you're going to have states playing. I mean, Ohio is going to have, if Ohio goes as is, when they have a football season, they do everything, they're going to have a normal high school lacrosse season for all of their kids, where we're going to be playing 8 to 12 games, and we're going to start in late May, and it's going to carry into the summer, and then it's going to bump up with club. And it's, you know, it just doesn't, right. I don't get it.
And I think Ohio's doing the situation where, because I guess COVID doesn't spread as much during the day and UV light and outdoors, they're keeping most of their games during the day for football, I think. I don't know if that's 100% true or not. That's a conversation I had with somebody. But that makes sense, right? That's a hard fact. We know that COVID is, you know, unless you're, making out with somebody, you know, chances are if it hits the air and there's UV light, you're in pretty safe situation. That's why the beaches in Delaware were open.
Eight a.m. to 10 a.m. I don't care, right? I mean, whatever protocols, whatever things need to happen in order for it to happen, you know, let's do it. But so, I mean, back to the point, you know, what's fall going to look like, right? What's fall going to look like? It's going to be busy, as I said. I mean, these high schools are all going to, I mean, the majority of them are going to do it, right? There's going to be practices.
Well, John,
it's going to be varsity, and it's going to be.
Getting back to your point. So, you know, I've talked in this podcast how I was really bummed in the spring that my 9-year-old, his first ever official season got canceled. And we talked about the seniors that didn't get their blast, but we also talked to people like Summer, who was going to be coaching Cass Tech, and the never evers didn't get their first. So I went out and I signed, you know, normally up here in Clarkston, we have something that for the little kids, well, they'll play on some Sundays and then they'll do a boo bash and that's it. Just a couple of Sundays, get the kids out, run them around, because they're all doing Chiefs football and they're all doing travel soccer and they're all doing robotics and Cub Scouts and catechism and everything else. So with none of that happening, I took Gannon and tried him out for Omnia. And you know, I've known J.D. Hess since he was a kid. And now my kid might be coached by J.D. Hess and DCAT. So I was like, yeah, if we're only going to do one Sunday, Gannon's, you know, spring was canceled, I'm going to get him a Tuesday, Thursday travel opportunity. I hope he makes the team. I'll still do Sundays with the Clarkston kids. I'll still coach that. My kid can play 3 days a week because he's not going to have all those other opportunities. As soon as football was canceled, Clarkston Chiefs, I guess, are going to cancel too. Cash cows, Clarkson Lacrosse said, well, we won't do Sundays. We'll go Tuesdays, Thursdays now. So now I can't coach my team because I've already written my check for my travel team for my kid, and I can't be in two places at once.
Yeah, well, I've heard that actually the last 2 days, really, of people, of parents saying to me, hey, you know, I made this club team, and now my high school is reaching out to me saying, hey, we're going to be doing 16 practices. You know, it's going to be taxing, right? I mean, you got school, right? I mean, that's first and foremost, especially if you're at home learning virtually. You know, I mean, yes, you want to get your, you know, son or daughter out moving around, but you know, what do you do? You know, what do you do now? And so I think there's going to be even more opportunities now. And so it's going to be important for parents to really weigh, what am I doing? You know, how old is my son? Right. I mean, you know, traveling out east isn't really the answer for, you know, kids in eighth grade or seventh grade because of recruiting and everything we've talked about. You know, maybe this isn't the year to do it if you've got practices or freshmen, right? Freshmen. So I think there's lots of opportunities for parents. I think they just need to weigh the options and you know, get the kids out there and just get them moving, right? Get them moving.
You know, we try to limit my wife and I as much screen time as my son has. If it was up to him, it would be Roblox, it would be Fortnite, it would be, you know, Minecraft, it would be Xbox, this and that.
Roblox, yes.
And we just, we try to really limit that. And now he's going to be educated by a screen 6 hours a day. I've got to get him out and get him moving. I've got, for his mental health, for his growth, for his development, he's got to get moving. So I really wish I could do something with him Mondays, Tuesday, or Tuesdays, Thursdays, and Sundays, but that might not be an option anymore. So I know we don't have the answers, but just like now it's affecting me personally, and that's why I'm even more upset. I'm not saying woe is me. I'm just saying it has affected me. You know, I'm seeing now that there's certain high school coaches that have come out and said, I can't coach football in the fall or in the spring. It affects my day job. It affects my income. I can't be doing practices and then coming back and doing more practices and games. How many people do we know are an official for football and for lacrosse? Is the football coach and the lacrosse coach? Is the football coach and the baseball coach? And again, I'm going back to the spring. You've got these places with one stadium. And football is king, and soccer, boys soccer, has to be kind of second class. Not my call. We just know what the culture is in the fall. Well, now, in the spring, say you've got one field and it's not field turf. Football's going to destroy that field. And now girls soccer, field hockey, girls lacrosse, and boys lacrosse are going to be playing in a mud pit.
Especially that early, if they are going as early as they said they did. I don't, you know, and we're – And you know, those poor indoor facilities that haven't been able to open, you know, I mean, how much is that time going to be worth and the value? And
how much is it going to cost?
I mean, can you imagine if they're going to be open? I think Joe Dumars Fieldhouse announced that they're closing for good today.
25 years.
I mean, it's
gone.
Just crazy. You know what I mean? That's a place that you kind of thought was printing money. And
well, they probably were, but you've only got so much of a runway where you're shut down, right? I mean, every business can stay afloat. You've got only so much of a financial runway before, all right, here's the end date. And if we don't get an influx of cash, is it worth it?
Financial runway. I like that.
Yeah. So, you know, just I'm very frustrated with this because for me, it seems like we're going to kick the can down the road and we'll figure it out. And logistically, I don't see how they're going to make it work.
Oh yeah. Well, that was one of my biggest things, because you look at Colorado, you look at some of the other states that came out and pushed, they all had plans. And so when they announced it, it was, here's what we're doing. Here's what it's going to look like. Here's what the plan is. And, you know, unfortunately MHSA came out and said, you know what, we'll get back to you in a couple months. It's like, oh, okay. And so now we just sit and wait and wait and wait and wait and wait. And you can't plan, you really can't do anything. And I understand that, you know, that nothing's set in stone, and it's difficult, and it's a challenge for the MHSA. I don't envy them in any way, shape, or form. They're caught between a rock and a hard place. If you do or you don't, you know, if they play football and tragedy happens or something, you know, whatever, who knows? So I get it. But, you know, I mean, that's what leadership is, right? Leadership is making decisions and coming up with a plan. And yes, that plan may have to be altered, but at least you give people an idea. I mean, right now I'm going around looking at every other state, right? I started a spreadsheet of the states that aren't playing and when they're starting to try to gauge what's going to happen, because how do you schedule games, right? I mean,
yeah, John, I completely agree with you on that. You know, one of the things that we're doing, because I'm dealing with a moving target in college lacrosse, is we continually are making, this is what it's going to look like. This is what it's going to look like. What happens if this happens? What happens if this happens? And you know, some people could think we're wasting time, but, you know, I've learned so much about, you know, between NCAA calls with doctors and trying to figure out what different patterns are going to look like. You know, to be honest with you, I have no answer, but I'm going to wake up every day trying to figure out a new plan that's going to be the best pathway to be the most successful we can be. And right. I don't get
it. You have to.
Yeah, I just don't get – I don't get why someone says, oh, we're just not – we're going to wait till we know. Well, I think the one thing we've learned over these past couple months is we don't know, so we better keep planning and keep bobbing and weaving with what we're doing.
It's what fuels part of the anxiety and the end of parents is the not knowing, right? Okay, we're not doing this. We're going to do that, or we might do that, but we have no idea what it's going to look like, and that affects every other spring sport when you drop gigantic, titanic football right in the middle of it to see what the ripple effect is, because the wake of that is going to be huge because it affects everything, right?
And I'll say this, with risk assessment in looking at this to say what should be safe and what shouldn't be safe. You've already heard me vent on, I don't want to hear safer, better, more, but I want to hear the science comes at. If I'm a parent of a 2021, hypothetically, my son Gannon is 18, not 9, and he is committed to go play Division I lacrosse, even, you know, MCLA in his future, I don't know. And he's going to finish his senior season July, mid-July?
Not happening.
And expected to be on campus at his new school August, mid-August?
Well, take a step back. Let's talk about the top football players in the state of Michigan. Right?
Oh, they're not playing in the spring. No way in hell they're playing in the spring. They're going to graduate early and go to campus. Go get on their university campus. There's no way that you risk that injury.
With all the universities, actually, you know, I've heard this rumbling now where you've got some schools that aren't playing football, right? That are talking about playing in the spring. You know, can we play in this? What are we going to do in the spring? And so you got high school students that are going to graduate, enroll in the spring at their college and university, and potentially start playing.
Yeah.
So you know, you think about what the state of Michigan is going to look like losing, you know, the top, I don't know, what, 20 player? I mean, who knows? I mean, you know, would you?
No.
I mean, no. I'm moving on with my life. I wanted to have my senior season. I wanted to finish with my classmates that I grew up with. I wanted to try and compete for a state championship, go out a winner. But it's not going to happen because my life now, I have to go into that next phase sooner than I wanted to. But it's what's best for me as a person and a player.
We preach over and over again about the multi-sport athlete not being specialization and not being a specialized player. The number of these kids that play football and baseball, football and lacrosse, football and run track, how many of them are going to say, I'm not going to risk an injury on these fields for football. I'll just play lacrosse or I'll just play baseball or I'll just play. They're going to lose their senior season anyway. And how many on the flip side are going to just walk away and just go, hey, you know what? I'm going to go backpack around Colorado with my boys because this has been a waste of a senior year for me anyway.
I mean, I have said that the spring sports need to go on and have a full season. And yes, football will be dropped in there. And yes, logistics and field time and all that stuff will be difficult. And the unfortunate part will be those two sport athletes.
Yeah.
But I would rather, you know, I mean, they are playing one of their two sports. And so really we're saying that they would just lose their second sport, which is unfortunate, or if they lose their fourth, whatever, they pick one or the other. But really, by pushing lacrosse, by pushing all these back, you know, you're affecting everyone who plays that sport. So, you know, I mean, there's no reason why schools can't go out and find places to play or play at odd hours or, you know, on the, you know, I mean, in my mind, you know, that's being creative. That's logistics, finding a way to practice somewhere, doing, you know, whatever that may be from a lacrosse standpoint, where it's got to be creative for 30 days while football winds down, and then you get everybody together and you have your season starting in May, the second half of your season, or whatever that looks like.
Well, yeah. The thing that scares me the most for the lacrosse landscape.
Snakes?
What's that?
The thing that scares you the most are spiders, snakes, clowns?
I know. I love spiders and snakes.
What about clowns?
Clowns?
I've been called a clown a lot, so.
Oh, you're a bum, but okay.
Bum is bad. But what scares me for the landscape of lacrosse is we have to remember that a lot of high school lacrosse programs are not sanctioned by the high school. What's that called? I don't even know what that's called, where they're clubs, you know, outside of the high school. And I'm really not going to take it well I don't know if I'm allowed to use an example, but I'm going to personally get really mad about the high school athletic director that says, well, you know, the sanctioned sports are going to be getting the privilege and the better times. And maybe even we're going to see some lacrosse teams at the high school level that have been, you know, pushing and a lot of people giving a lot of hard work and a lot of time, getting
knocked,
knocked out, you know, knocked out and say, hey, you guys aren't playing this year because of the situation. You know, I think that's a real concern. I'm not sure what to do about it, except, you know, I'm going to be, you know, because I know how hard some of those coaches and parents and people work, you know, to start a program at a public school.
Yeah.
That's going to be really disturbing.
It's our buddy Liberty up in Traverse City. You know, it's guys like that that have a unified program or you know, are struggling to find, you know, indoor gym time at the Y because their fields aren't going to be
right.
ready and able to go, and especially if football's there. So,
well, you know, but and you look at, like, okay, let's go to the scenario that Ohio and Indiana are having normal seasons and they're starting in March, right? They're playing games March and April, and we're not starting until May. And then those two, I mean, it's going to eliminate playing. And I know that only affects a certain amount of schools. But, you know, I mean, if you open it up and allow teams to play a normal season, right, and maybe they don't have the home field and maybe they don't have any home games and maybe they do have to carpool and travel to Toledo to play. I mean, you know, that there's, you know, it's just, I just don't, you know, you got places like Wisner Stadium. I mean, you've got places that you can play games and practice for that matter. Just to shut it down and say, all right, football's here, boom, we're dropping it. Everything's pushed to May, and you're going to play 8 games, then you have the playoffs, and you'll be done by July. It's like,
you play lacrosse games at Wisner?
Of course.
It's a small field, but we'll make it work.
You play lacrosse games there? I wonder who thought of that.
It's fine. It's fine. I mean, that you know, but it's places like that, you know, that you can do things or, you know, I mean, the creativity, the lack of creativity is what bothers me, right? It's like, it has to be in a box, right? Okay, here, football is not being played, and now we're going to drop it right here, and then everything else is going to get pushed back incrementally so that it all fits in this nice little tidy package, rather than having the creativity to say, all right, you know what, not May, all right, maybe we start in April, and maybe there is an overlap because all the football teams aren't going to make the playoffs, right? So we're going to wait till all of football is done before we start lacrosse? Really? Why? If you've got 8-12 teams left, yet the rest of the state is done, but we can't because we're going to wait based on this guideline, based on this time frame.
Great idea, John.
And I'll go back to, you know, just kind of the attitude of the MHSAA. I heard Mark Yule on the Huge Show, and he had made a comment something about, you know, wanting to get it right. And I'm paraphrasing. I apologize if this seems like a misquote. But he referred to the for-profits just waiting to pounce. And the word he used was pounce on these kids. And I'm going, you've abandoned lacrosse players in 2020, and you've given them no path to a season that makes any sense to any of us in 2021. These kids want to play. These kids need exercise. These kids need recruiting and leadership opportunities. These kids just need hand-eye coordination and exercise.
Structure.
The for-profits are now pouncing? How about they're filling a void that the MHSAA is supposed to be providing? I didn't like the fact that he made it seem as if the for-profits, the clubs, the leagues are pouncing.
Isn't the MHSAA a for-profit? They're not nonprofit. They're for-profit.
I believe they are listed as a not-for-profit, but they are not.
I want to double-check that. I'll bet you lunch that they're not non-for-profit.
Well,
I think they lost their status.
Yeah, 501c3. You know, I mean, I don't know how they're funded if they're not-for-profit. I don't know. I mean, I don't even want to go into that.
Yeah, let's not go into that.
I don't want to know. I don't want to know.
I don't think certain people at the MHSA like me very much anyway, so.
Look, I don't think I have any friends or enemies there that would be surprised. And I mean by friends or enemies, I have friends there. But I don't think I've burned any bridges with my comments. I think they know that I'm frustrated as a lacrosse guy. And I think that lacrosse needs a seat at the table in some of these conversations. And lacrosse, just like boys and girls lacrosse and girls soccer and baseball, have been the forgotten stepchild in all this.
Well,
and I'm not happy about it. And I'm not going to – I didn't attack Mark Yule personally. I've never attacked Tom Ration personally, but I'm not happy with their role in this and the decisions they have or haven't made. And I think that needs to be said.
There is a leadership group, Chris. You know who they are. So.
Yeah, and we looked it up, the council, on one of our previous podcasts, and I ran through the list of them, and it was ADs, and it was the Detroit school superintendent, and it was coaches, and it was principals, and it was, you know, this whole cast of characters.
Dr. Vitti.
I don't know any of them, but they're on there.
I like Dr. Vitti. Hey, no, but here's my thing, real quick. I promised you that you don't see lacrosse mentioned in articles, interviews. Nobody says anything, and I don't know if it's on purpose, but, you know, I mean, here's the thing, and I put this out on social media today when they were talking about it. I'm like, what's the only two sports in the spring that share a field with football, right? Lacrosse and girls soccer, right? That's pretty much that's the majority. That covers all the bases, and who are going to be the ones that have a two-sport athlete that would do both? Well, that's going to be boys lacrosse. So boys lacrosse has two of the biggest factors in this whole thing that are going to be affected, right? Two sport athlete, football and lacrosse, and sharing the same field, right? Baseball not sharing the same field, right? Could have two sport athletes, but they don't hit both criteria. But no one talks about lacrosse.
And I know that the MHSAA does not sanction girls field hockey, but I know there's a number of schools that have girls field hockey programs as well that they're dealing with.
Maybe I want to move into that area.
All right. So I don't want to just treat this as a complaint session. I think, John, you've got some really valid points that this fall is going to be a nightmare for those that have football. Technically, they're still practicing without pads and no decision has been made, I guess.
Yeah, no, it'll be done. Yeah, so football ends the end. So let me think about this. The end of September. So they're going now until the end of September. So lacrosse, for instance, is going to go the same time in September. They're going to be sharing. But then football's done, and then lacrosse will have their month in October, and then they're done. So, you know, you're going to have 16 practice, like I said, from September 8th until October 31st, Halloween, you get 16 practices with your coaching staff. And that's going to be that. No competitions, no scrimmages, no, none of that. And you're going to have that. And I would assume that, you know, but you have some, I mean, we know, like we talk about the schools that, you know, the schools that don't have a strong program. I mean, I don't think you're going to have coaches out there, you know, trying to rustle kids up. You know, to go out and run drills twice a week, right? I mean,
yeah.
I don't know.
So beginning Monday, August 24th, out-of-state football is allowed 16 voluntary coach-player contact days with more than four players with helmets only until October 31st. So this is saying that they can go till the 31st.
They get more time than everyone else, of course.
But they're still only allowed 16 voluntary practices. And then spring sports are allowed those same 16 practices, but they start September 8th and can only go 31st.
Right. So if you're a football program and you're continuing to go right now, then you're going to be done, right? You're going to be, I mean, you look at the calendar, you're going to be done. If you go twice a week, you go 3 days a week, depends on what, I mean, football is going to have more, probably more variance in what schools do, right? Do you want to go 3 days a week and then be done? Or do you want to stretch it out? I mean, what's going to be more beneficial? But that's where the communication between, you know, within the schools to say, all right, hey, coach, how long you want to go for? And then we'll start up or we'll have a little bit of an overlap where there's got to be so much, you know, that you need to have everyone working for the betterment of the kids at each school between the coaches to make sure that you have those two sports and that everyone gets a fair shake at the field time.
I just hope that within these schools that the coaches are communicating, you know, I follow all these people on social media that are still planning protests at the state capitol saying, let the kids play. I would like to hope that it's not officially dead. And I guess if anyone wants to say, well, sports reopening, they decided on the 20th and what reality is. They changed it 6 days before that. They changed it 15 days before that. They changed it 13 days before that. They keep changing. So change it again and say, we're going to do football and we're going to delay the start, or maybe we're going to take away some games can still get football in the fall. I still hope that they can get it done, but.
No, it's not going to happen. I mean, you had a lot of states that pushed it, the start date back until really, September 11th, second, third week in September, shorten the season. I broke down a whole list of when the game started on social media that'll show you the top 20 or something like that in terms of the states. So, I mean, there's somebody, again, it goes back to the creativity, right? It appears to me that it's like it has to be in this box, right? All right, not doing it. Done. Not going to talk about it again. We'll come up with a plan, and then we'll try to figure out in a couple of months or something like that. Like, it has to be – it doesn't have to be perfect. Nothing is perfect in this pandemic, in this society that we're living in right now. Chaotic is the word, right? And flexibility. It's, you know, it's optics. It's you know, we want to do what's right, but you say what you want to do, what's right, but then you pull the rug out from under them and you give mixed messages. It's hard. It's hard to, as a parent, look your kid in the eye, and especially as a coach as well, to say, this is what the plan is. This is what we're doing. You know, I mean, I guarantee you that the high school coaches, those football coaches, never said, hey, we're going to start practice today. Now, there's a chance in 2 weeks we're going to completely stop and be shut down till the spring, right? I don't think anyone was talking like that, because that really wasn't what was coming out.
Yeah, I agree. All right. Do we want to transition into college 2021, or what college fall ball might look like, Coach, or your new coaching staff, your recruits? Like, I kind of want to talk about some positive stuff. And
well, there's not going to be. There's not going to be a real fall. There's not going to be any fall competitions across the country. I mean, I think the only team I've seen practicing is Navy, and you know, those guys have been living in a bubble. They kind of live at the academy. They kind of live in the bubble, so it's a different situation.
Yeah,
we're going to start in September. They're going to start working out voluntarily, socially distanced. We've got our pavilion is set up as a weight room, so it'll be outdoors to help that situation. We're actually going to start with them wearing masks while they're lifting. Also, which is going to be an interesting thing. And then we're going to move to small groups in the middle of September. And, you know, I'm not sure if we'll get beyond that, to be completely honest with you. I think we might stay at 10 people or less all the way through Thanksgiving when most of the colleges are leaving. That's when we're leaving and they're taking their finals at home. That's where I stand today. We've got practice plans if things change and they get to full practices, or if they go down to 3 people at a time, or if we have to do back to individual work. So, we're all trying to get to January and February, where we're playing some sort of a season, however that looks. You know, if the Big Ten ends up playing just themselves, you know, we won't play Ohio State and Michigan. If they'll play us, we'll play Ohio State, Michigan. It's going to be very, you know, nobody really knows anything about what's going on with scheduling outside of your conference. So, you know, we're just going to, I think everybody's plan at the collegiate level is, you know, let's get these rules right. Let's get the numbers down as best we can. Let's do our part to do that. And hopefully by, some good things happen with the testing. I know this new test, I think the White House is using, where you get a pretty good response and the cost is much less than, you know, I think whatever, it's $150 now and the current one that they're using, and there's, you know, false positives and it takes a little bit longer. The new one is a saliva test and it goes quicker. I think, John, you probably would know more about that, but hopefully that situation happens. I think if that test is positive, we have a really good chance of having a season, because we can test people, and then hopefully a vaccine, you know, happens, and then we're in really good shape. But I think right now everyone's just trying to stay healthy, trying to stay safe, trying to get the guys the best you can, you know, get them together as you can. You know, we're doing a lot of stuff online still. You know, this is a uncharted territory forever. I think for any college freshman or anybody returning to college, they're doing something that nobody before them has ever done. So you know, I can't imagine, you know, trying to be being on a team or dating or going to school. All these things that everyone is trying to do now from a social context is so much different. So it's, you know, we're just trying to support them the best they can.
Actually, while we're sitting here, 17 minutes ago, I got an email from Kevin O'Leary, who's the executive director for NILOA. NILOA is the National Intercollegiate Lacrosse Officials.
Hand whistles?
Yeah, not hand whistles. But we're the officials that are contracted by the NCAA, the MCLA, and the NAIA to officiate college games. And basically, he's talking about training, because normally we use the fall for training. We use it for practicing on new rules, giving feedback to the rules committee on what works, doesn't work. We use the chance for tryouts for new guys. And he says, as of this writing, I'm not going to give you all the names, but we're trying to secure fall events we can use for training and tryouts at this time. NCAA D1 has not scheduled any fall scrimmages. D2 and 3 may be conducting local or inter-squad scrimmages. We will continue to speak to the D2 and D3 assigners about these opportunities. You know, basically right now, even the MCLA board has reached out to each of their conference coordinators, requested they contact their assigners with any scrimmage opportunities we can use for training. So we as officials,
we're
trying.
Yeah, we're all trying. I'm feeling good about it. I think it's going to look different. I think you're going to see teams playing less games. I think you're going to see some more regional games, which would be cool. You might see some home and home situations with certain schools that you've never seen before, which would be pretty cool, I think. If you just want to be positive about it, I think it's an interesting new way to look at things. And I mean, we just all want to get back and play, right? So we've all got our way of trying to do that. You know, we're just trying to follow the rules that the NCAA and the schools are setting for us, because, you know, it's really important to the guys. It's really important to the coaching staff. I think it's important for the community. So,
yeah, no, I agree. Yeah. I mean, I think, you know, I mean, everyone's got their own responsibility and what they need to do. Right. If, you know, especially in the collegiate environment where easily, you know, someone doesn't wear their mask, whatever. Right. I mean, you can get it any way, shape or form. Right. We know this, but you know, the thing is that as long as you can look yourself in the mirror every day and say, you know what, as a college athlete, I followed the rules, right? You may still be infected with this because it's such an infectious disease. Right. But the thing for college athletes and high, I mean, just follow the rules. Just do what you're supposed to do, and what's going to happen is going to happen, right?
It's better to complain about COVID. One of the things I've been telling people, it's complain about COVID rules in the car and not how your kid played. Tell him he played great. Tell him you enjoyed playing, watching him play. If you want to complain about mask rules, go, and the difference between Maryland and Michigan, go for it.
You're absolutely right on that. I agree with you 100% on that we need to focus on the positive. You know, try to offer our suggestions, positives where we can. I read a great tweet right before my son tried out for his first travel team, and oh my gosh, he was so nervous. But our buddy over at Stinson Mallor, Sean Higgins, gave him a little pep talk. Gannon looks up to Stitch, and he's got more Stinson Mallor gear than Losey has. So Gannon really got his little pep talk, got out there, saw DCAT, got his confidence going a little bit. And I read a tweet that just said, if you want to tell your kids something after a game or a scrimmage, just tell them how much you love watching them play.
Well, watching them play. I read that a number of years ago when I was going through mine. So, yeah.
And I made the biggest rookie mistake of all time. I'm not used to not being the ref on the field or the coach in the field. You people bring lawn chairs. I was sitting my ass on the hot AstroTurf.
I pace. I sit down and get sun.
Chris, I just sent you probably the greatest lacrosse bag in the history. I don't know how to put it on Zoom. I sent it to you, Lovesy, too.
Oh, yeah.
I know, Drew, and you like gear, and then you're talking about gear.
Oh, this is phenomenal.
I have
Where did
two
you
coming.
Find this?
It's a taco.
I have two coming. to my house.
Well, hold on. Let me share the first one before you share the second one. I'm afraid if you're going to share the second one. This is the San Antonio Tacos.
Yeah, my friend Mike Brand runs that program, and he came up with that lacrosse bag.
That is fantastic. All right, let me unshare before you send whatever's next, because I'm afraid.
No, I'm just, that's all I'm sending.
Okay, good.
Yeah, yeah.
As far as bags, yes, the San Antonio Tacos is – it doesn't – they're not the Taco Supremes. They don't see sour cream.
No, they have the little kids are called taquitos.
Even better. Even better.
I'm going to have taquitos as soon as we're done. I eat a lot of taquitos.
Favorite thing in the world.
You know, yeah. you mentioned youth lacrosse, right? So, I mean, we talked high school, we talked college. You know, the youth program, I don't know, you know, I'm not as connected to the youth program as I used to be. So I don't know if you got, you know, I mean, there's a lot of, you know, younger, newer programs out there trying to crop up. I mean, I've seen more, that's one thing I want to talk about. I've seen more new club teams in Michigan than I've ever seen. I mean, it's been an influx, and it's got a lot to do with the situation. And I think a lot of programs were going all in on the fact that as soon as football was canceled, like, we're all in. So there's a lot of options for a lot of teams out there to, a lot of kids to go out there and play.
Yeah. And I haven't kept my pulse on it that much. I will say this. I know so many people that even when Gannon was just first starting out, and I've said this to everybody, I have been so trying hard to be the hands-off dad that he fell in love with it, and I wasn't trying to live vicariously through him, that maybe he's a little behind where he needs to be. And we've gotten invites from a number of travel teams, and we just weren't comfortable with pushing him out there. My wife and I just sat back and said he wasn't ready. But then this fall, we finally said, well, darn it, if he lost the spring season, let's try it. And there was really only one that we were looking at because of our relationship with J.D. Hess and in the Omnia program. Yeah. So I haven't kept my finger on the pulse of it just because I kind of had the blinders on to go where a guy I'm loyal to. I saw a lot of bags out there. I saw a lot of, you know, programs that are old, programs that are new. As far as youth goes, I know that Kaminskis runs some of the best youth programs. I know that, not programs, tournaments. I know Ken Brubaker's been doing stuff over the years. I know that there's been other ones from, you know, the NXTs and everything else. I don't know what the future holds. The conversation I last had with Kaminskis was that they're going to still try to do a boobash, but
the city
of Oxford might not let them have Seymour Lake Park. I know Brubaker's going to still try to do the Donnybrook.
Yeah, they got boobash set for Erie.
Yeah, I thought I saw Fort Wayne.
Oh, okay. I've got it because I've got this whole thing because I'm building out all kinds of.
I'm like, if I have it right, you're wrong. I'm going to be.
Well, let's do this. The three of us, we're going to commit to doing these on Tuesdays. Sound good? We'll at least do one a week. We'll start bringing in some more guests because we had a whole backlog of people that we wanted to talk to, needed to talk to.
Bring in James Thomas, man. James Thomas wants it. We got to bring him in. That's my guy.
I'm sure he does. That's we have to go back and get Izzy because we screwed that one up.
Erie, Pennsylvania.
Okay.
Yeah, so, right. I had a wrong shoot.
October 17th and 18th, Boobash Lax Festival, Erie, Pennsylvania.
Are they doing another one in Erie? I'm thinking off the top of my head. Is there anything that the Lax
might be. I don't know. I mean, Erie, Pennsylvania, the home of Anacott Steel. Blue Horseshoe loves
Anacott Steel. Go look that one up, kids. It's a movie quote. Blue Horseshoe loves Anacott Steel.
What box is Sir Larry going to fall on in Erie, Pennsylvania? He's buying Anacott Steel.
Perfect.
What box? What else? What other problems can we solve today, gentlemen?
Colin, do we want to talk about your new coaching staff? Do we want to touch on Chuck Hayes' summer with the Denver Outlaws?
Chuck was amazing, right? Chuck was amazing.
He's awesome. He's so much fun to watch.
Yeah, he's great. You know, he just has such great timing, and he's just such a great
motor.
Athlete.
He's got a motor.
Know, motor. He's got such a great. There's not a better short stick takeaway guy. I think in the country, and I have a lot of people that watch him closely that are pretty high level people that agree with me on that. And his timing is incredible. It's always been incredible. And he works, you know, his diet, his training, everything he does is just so intense. And, you know, it's pretty awesome. He's pretty awesome to have around as an example.
All right, let me share this. This was just put out by the Denver Outlaws Twitter account for their first goal of the season in the MLL. You got hazed.
Yeah, so, I mean, you look, he's playing the pick so well, as he always does. And he pushed, you know, there's so many little things he does there with the push off. You know, the guy's trying to set a pick, and he's just like, screw you, I'm going to push you.
Yeah.
And then, as he's watching, he's watching the other guy, picks off the pass.
Watch him run. Right, he's going left, he sees that, and then he goes back, he veers back right.
He's the pressure, moves away from it. I mean, I've seen him do that thousands of times. Yeah. And practice that thousands of times. Sometimes, you know, he has to go half speed when I'm chasing him, but, he's...
Hey, what about the PLL and really having center stage as it relates to sports in the, really in the country? I mean, that was...
Yeah, they did a great job.
I thought it was fascinating because I was traveling a lot and the kids were all getting together to watch games. They were talking about, it was the first time that I saw really high school kids, like, hey, whose room, what room are we going to watch the game tonight? Right. It was interesting.
I mean, I think the MLL did a great job with the games that were broadcasted. I think, Denver and the Bayhawks are as good as any PLL team. And I mean, the PLL was incredible. I mean, the Whipsnakes defense is just it's a thing of beauty to watch, right? Watching sometimes, Tom Schreiber with those guys on the Archers, it's incredible to watch them play and the things that they're doing. They're going to push the game forward, and that's the point.
They have the late night games. Like my older son, John, I'm like, I'm going to bed. He's like, oh, what are you talking about? The game starts at 11. I'm like, what are you talking about? He's like, and so that, I thought that was very cool to really see the, that it take hold just because of everything that we've been going through.
I'm sorry, just to say, I agree with you that it was very cool that they put their guys in a bubble and they found a way to make it work. For me, last season, knowing I just had to find games on Saturday and Sunday, and I could have an iPad out while camping with my kids, or I could kind of work my schedule around Saturdays, Sundays, that many games in that short of a time, I did not get to be a part of the storylines and the excitement of some of that stuff.
It wasn't for you.
Twitter the next day.
Yeah, that was one of the arguments from a lot of people, and some of the guys that are older had trouble recovering. But that was the argument. Some people like that Saturday, consistency, versus the me with if I was out on the road, watching games all day, and then turning those games on at night, I probably would have fallen asleep a lot. I was pretty excited watching most of them.
And I'll be honest, it's no secret that last season I was all in on the Atlas because of my relationship with you and John Paul, and I was rooting for my buddies. Yeah. And some of my favorite players in the league, whether it was Unterstein or it was Baptiste, they've got some of my favorite players, and I'm buddies with the coaches. I could work my schedule around, what's the Atlas doing? How are they doing in the rest of the league? Without you guys there this year, I still watched, I still rooted. But again, it wasn't as much. If this was low C, we'll talk about the NCAA tournament. If one of our favorite teams is the round of 64 West Coast last game, we're getting a couple of monsters and we're making a couple of cocktails and we're staying up and watching it because that's our team.
Sure.
It was a Tuesday 11 o'clock start game on the PLL with two teams that didn't really follow. Like I said, I'm going to bed. I don't have time for this.
Well, we couldn't go to a bar anyway because we were all locked down. So, what they did was they did it right, right? They needed a stage, right? They looked at what was going on. They used it as an opportunity. They did it right, and they got their brand out there that reached more people than they normally would have reached. Now, will it resonate? Who knows, right? Yeah, but that time, during that space, they did it right.
They got up to, on some of those games, to almost like Mountain West football type crowds, which lacrosse, that's humongous.
Huge.
That's a huge TV. That's a pretty good situation. So,
yeah.
You know,
I think too, cool. As much as the Twitter mob from either side of the political spectrum and the weirdos on the complete outskirts of it. Lacrosse Twitter started to get kind of weird during the PLL with bets and mic'd ups and personal attacks. I'm not sure if that's where we need to take this, but
COVID.
I have a little bit of inside information. That's a whole nother podcast.
All right. Or maybe that's over some gin sometime. But, you know, some of those award winners, I mean, especially you look at Zed Williams and what he brought. I mean, that final was ridiculous. He was untouchable, unstoppable. It was amazing.
The whole chaos story, I had some inside conversations with that too, but their whole, that whole story, not winning the game and then catching fire, like who doesn't like that, right?
Yeah.
And kind of switching some stuff up, you know, probably sitting one of the best players in the league, and then going to, American line, Canadian line. It was just a cool story.
It was cool. The whole thing was cool.
The whole thing was great. Yeah.
All right. Can I go back to the MLL and one quote I just wanted to read you guys? I finally found it. And this is to blow smoke at my buddy Chuck Hayes. They were giving their end of the season awards, and their player of the year, defensive player of the year, they gave it to Adler, who's their face-off guy. Adler has won 479 of 820 face-offs for 58.4%, 29 career games, blah, 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 blah. A championship team remains focused and unified. Team confidence begets individual confidence and optimizes full potential. Adler knows his teammates have his back. And here's his quote. My teammates always support me whether or not I'm playing well. The wings have the biggest impact. We have the best wings in the league. Charlie Hayes doesn't get any credit, but is the best teammate in lacrosse.
100%.
Rodney Dangerfield. Rodney Dangerfield.
And new assistant coach at Detroit Mercy.
Yeah.
Official. We broke that on one of the few last podcasts we had reviewing the All-Decade team.
Oh, yeah.
And, Coach, you picked up a grad assistant in the last week?
We are sharing a grad assistant with our women's program. So he'll be spending some time with the women's probably at this point because there's been a little bit of a situation with the assistant coach for the women is coming in a little bit later. He'll be working with them too. He's a nice guy. I'm sure we could probably have him on the podcast when he gets in town. So,
cool.
Yeah, he's doing both programs and working a master's in psychology. So it's going to be a very interesting. You know how much we like our player development profile. So it's nice to have somebody who can actually manage data and isn't a mess like me.
And we know that it's not always the case where the men's and women's programs are harmonious, but the relationship you have with Coach Hicks on the women's side, I mean, mentor mentee, it doesn't get much better than that.
Yeah. We're going to do a lot more together than we've ever done in the past. And again, I've had a great relationship with every women's coach at Detroit thus far, but Coach Hicks, we're in a different category.
Yeah. All right.
Wait, Coach, when do you think you're going to build a schedule?
Our MAC schedule is complete.
So you have it?
Huh?
So you've got a schedule now.
We have our conference schedule is all set.
Okay.
I thought I gave that to you already for home games. No, we get four.
No, of course not. I built my world around it.
Yeah, I'll get it to you. And then our out of conference is really a moving target for everybody.
Right, COVID.
Because we all have so many different guidelines and the guidelines are moving I have no idea. I have a lot of different teams on the calendar, some of the traditional ones, some new ones. I've got a lot of dates and situations, but
contingencies.
Yeah. Who knows if Ultimate Soccer is going to be open, right?
Right. You have no idea. I mean, that's the thing. I mean, you got to build it. You got to have something. You got to have contingencies in place. I mean, that was I commended a couple of programs this summer, locally, because they had contingency plans, right? Okay, here's what the plan is, but this could change at any minute. And then behind the scenes, you know, they're piecing things together like, okay, if this doesn't go, then we go here and then we can do this and move it around, because, you know, the kids who got to play all summer are going to remember this. You're always going to remember where you were during this time.
Yeah.
And I've stressed it to a lot of my friends from a parenting standpoint to say, hey, listen, I know things might be getting you down, but your kids are always going to remember this, and they're going to remember how you handled it, right? How you handled this COVID situation, and they're going to remember where they were and what their summer was, the summer of COVID. And for the club programs that did as well as they did and were able to do it safely and really put the effort in, you know, Triumph Lacrosse and Omnia were the two that my kids played with, but I know a number of other programs did a great job, and the kids are going to remember it.
Yeah, some coaches worked really hard. Nice to see. You know, I know True did a nice job. Just Sherry's did a nice job.
Yep.
Yeah, it was good.
So, USL update. I don't know if you guys got the newsletter from Bryce, but Bryce has been very good about trying to keep momentum going forward in the Midwest with what's going on in lacrosse in the area. Very much just keeping us updated on what's going on with USL. They're hurting. Their donations are down. Their membership is down. They weren't able to provide a lot of the grants and services they have. One very good positive out of Michigan is we now have a board. We have a new treasurer in Brian Feeney. Brian is an official that does football and lacrosse, both at the college level now as well, out of the Lansing area. Played both in high school and college, and I should tease him. I don't know if he ever officially did a college game. He and I were supposed to be doing a Grand Valley game the Saturday before, or the Saturday after COVID hit. So he's soon to be a college official, I guess, but Brian's got a financial background. He's taken over for treasurer. Anna Kalush is our vice president. She's a women's official from here in the Detroit area. And then Aaron Boos is a dad that his kids are no longer a part of the game, but he said, damn it, I want to stay involved in the game. I want to give back. And he's going to hop on as our treasurer. And awesome. So since then, we've also reached out to some of the members of the Coaches Association for the men and women to see if they want seats on as a non-voting seat on the board. We're starting those conversations. We don't want them voting because it could be a conflict of interest with their finances and their goals, but just really want to kind of increase the communication with the officials associations, the coaches associations, and U.S. lacrosse. And like John, you were saying with contingency plans, one thing that we really want to try to get going this fall is the coaches development programs, but we don't know. We normally do those in gyms. Yeah. And if we get access, like, I can't even go to my kids' elementary school during remote learning and pick up a laptop for them. I have to make an appointment to get it outside the classroom. My wife is a teacher at a Catholic school, and they're going face-to-face, but only X number of parents are allowed in the school during the day, and those are the ones doing temperature checks. And if you're not one of those parents, you're not allowed in the building. So I don't know where we're going to get a gym from. I don't know where we'd get an outdoor field if every single for-profit club is going to be competing for field time too. So we don't have a contingency plan yet. We're going to talk to CDP. We're going to talk to Bryce. CDP is a coaches development program. And we're going to talk to Bryce, and we're going to see if we can do something online, do something virtual, because we want to start training some of these new coaches and getting our social media going again and getting, you know, this podcast rolling again and start really trying to do some recruiting and get some grants and some programs and some fundraising going. But we've just been kind of treading water for summer as we've been trying to get back to normal.
But you know, I think we tie Cosgrove to a chair. We put the camera in front of the computer, and then we just open it up for, like, you know, coaches to come on there and ask Cosgrove questions. I think that's really cool.
Well, most money we would raise would be Colin asking him stories about his playing days.
Or well, listen, we've got that. We've got that tape.
We actually have a tape of that, Chris.
We've got that. We've got that archive, and there's some juicy stuff in there.
I'm not too shy, but a little. It's like, maybe we shouldn't post this one.
we've got that in the vault, and that is tucked away nicely, because that's got some big names in the lacrosse world going back 20 years and some crazy stories. I was loving it.
Very nice.
He's it's Paul.
Yeah,
my buddy.
All right, so
we're talking.
Good to chat with you guys. Good to be back again.
Yeah, man. It's nice to, like, that this feels normal.
Yeah. Right.
Yeah. Yeah, it's like, boy, you know, boy, my life has been so miserable, but I'm glad I'm back on Zoom with you guys.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
All right, so let's set this for a goal.
And you didn't notice either, my ESPN stuff finally came in. I've been bugging them for, I don't know, maybe 2 years. And stuff, some random package just came, and so I got ESPN shirts now.
There you go. You're ready. You're an ESPN broadcaster. What do you want?
Exactly.
Well, I'm going to share this again.
Hammering them with emails for months.
I have the Sammy Sotomayor hooligan shirt on order.
Oh, you do?
Yeah, that's my guy. So,
you know, this is the number 40. This is the Higgins jersey. They started sharing their jerseys, and I, as a smart Alex, said, give you $100 for the Higgins jersey, and I get a direct message. When do you want to pick that up?
Yeah, exactly.
Oh, really? I didn't follow up with that. If they charge you $100, I'm going to get a Sammy jersey.
They gave me the home, they gave me the away, and they gave me a pair of shorts. So
for $100, that's good.
Yeah, so Gannon has been wearing this more like a dress, but I told him I'm wearing it on the podcast tonight. But these are nice. They got the city clubhouse on the one side. They've got the field house on the other. These are nice. They're, you know, if I ever played box again, probably not going to happen. You know, I'd rock one of these.
I'm thinking about it.
People like you. People hate officials. They will take shots at me for calls.
Oh, yeah, I have every kid that thinks they should have played at U of D goes after me. So
this is true. All right. So
nobody likes me. At least you guys got somebody in your corner. So I just get darts.
We like you.
That's true.
Two of us like you. All right. So
hey, listen. The difference is the old me. I deserve not to be like now.
This is true.
I'm positive, and I'm fact-driven. It's not emotional. Anything I put out there is just facts. Just the facts, man.
Facts according to you.
Wow.
No. Don't you play that game with me, Christopher Cullen.
All right.
Okay, so I'll call your mom.
Here's the homework. Group text. We're going to figure out a guest for next Tuesday.
Cosgrove.
No, we've had Cosgrove. We need to make sure we get our arms around what tournaments or events might be coming up. Any news that might happen over the next couple of weeks. We'll do the first
right now.
Couple of intro minutes as the three of us bring a guest on. And then we just make sure that every Tuesday we're back together. This thing renders overnight. I'll publish it every Thursday or so. And if something happens, breaking news, but I have a life again. I have kids going back to school and a wife going back to work, and I've been going
I've been in the office
5 days a week for 3 months.
Do we want to attempt maybe a socially distant
yes
in person?
Yes.
Yes.
At the Sensen Miller location in the garage. I told you guys that.
Place, if we, even if we could do a daytime and open the, I mean, there's a lot we could do there with the, to be safe and follow the rules. And maybe I have a setup that I think I could bring that would work.
I'm game. We could even get Higgins.
I would need your microphone, John.
Of course.
Oh, you have a mic? Yeah, okay, good.
Yeah.
All right, I got to eat my taquitos.
All right, so go follow U.S. Lacrosse. Go join U.S. Lacrosse, uslacrosse.org/join. He is at Chris Cullen. He is at Lax Losey. I am at Chris Druin. We're going to try to get our social going again. Follow us on Facebook /USL Michigan, I think. Good to be back. Everyone stay safe. We've missed you. We hope we bring a little bit of education, entertainment. Subscribe, click, whatever. But it's just good to be back, guys. So on behalf of John and Chris, thank you very much. See ya.